So I'm going to introduce Dr. Strayhorn, who you probably heard this morning through his wonderful speech, but I will just do a short and brief introduction. So Dr. Terrell Strayhorn is professor and founding CEO of Do Good Work Educational Consulting, LLC, a research consulting firm dedicated to conducting high quality, rigorous research that can be effectively translated into improving practices, informing decisions, strengthening communities, and ensuring success. By redefining student success, we're changing lives, quote, and helping others continue hashtag do good work for all students. So you wanted me to do a brief introduction, so without further ado, here is Dr. Strayhorn.
Thank you. I appreciate that. Please, a round of applause for that introduction. The last session we had, in my opinion, such little time that I figured rather than spend half our time together going through my bio, why not just cut it down, and then that'll free us up to move pretty quickly into some conversation and hopefully a few more mechanics than I think we really got through in the last session. So what we're gonna try to, or I think what we've been talking about today is certainly sense of belonging and student engagement. This particular session, we're gonna focus on issues that impact our ability to work with and engage students of color. And my contact information is still the same. If you're a person who has questions and you want to ask them, it looks like this is a smaller group than the last. So we certainly will have time to get through quite a bit of questions. But if you are a person who needs to think about those questions, you want to connect afterwards, then feel free to shoot me an email. Even while we're sitting here, you can shoot me an email. And I'll respond to those when we get an opportunity. But it is, in smaller settings like this, it's always great because you get to know a little bit more about the people in the room. So I'm just gonna ask a couple of you if you'll introduce yourself, and that is to tell us your name, what you do here at LBCC, and also if you know that there is something you want to address in this session, a question that's on your mind, something you absolutely know you wanna talk about, then go ahead and plug it now. Your name, what you do here at LBCC, and then something's on your mind or a question, I'll take notes to make sure that we cover them by the end, but I'd love for a couple people to introduce themselves that way. We'll just start with volunteers. And then of course, like most good instructors, I'll just pick somebody.
Matt Wilson, I'm here at the college. I was with the fire service for many years. I retired about 32 and a half years in the fire service. I've been teaching part-time at the college. Fire-related subjects, and now I'm full-time. And I'm here because I feel like with my background and working in a diverse culture with the fire service and the community, I feel like we're doing a pretty good job, but we can do better. And I want to learn how we can do that here at the college.
Thanks, Brad.
There you go.
I'm Mike Biggs. I used to be Brad's friend. I teach administration of justice here. I'm also the department chair of public services. And the question I have and reason I'm here is we're a pretty diverse college. It seems to me that just from my snapshot of my students that I have, we have very few African-American males, and those students tend to underachieve, in my opinion. I think there's way more in these students than I'm able to get out of them, and I'm hoping to learn how to do that better.
Mike?
Hi, I'm Kathy Crane. I teach performing arts, and I'm a department chair. I just quickly wrote a note, as I'm getting older here, I know I'm taking on more negative teaching philosophies as opposed to when I started. And I feel like my philosophy has been I build more walls than I build bridges. And I know some of that for me is my own insecurity as a teacher. So I've gotten to more lecture mode as opposed to inquisition. So looking for help, how's that?
Absolutely, thank you very much.
Is it on? Hi, my name is Heidi, and my job here at the college, I'm a faculty member, but my title is instructional specialist. And my job is to help run student success centers here on campus. And we have a really great ability or the possibility to impact a large number of students each semester. For example, in the fall semester, we served 10,000 students, right? That's a big chunk of our students here at the college. And so I'd like to learn more strategies for creating greater engagement and conditions of belonging for students. You mentioned a strategy in your opening session, which I thought was like really simple, but just like, wow, oh, you know, the candy thing. So that would be really helpful. Plus, we also have a student success class in our department, which is aimed at helping students, you know, succeed in college. So strategies that we can embed in that class would be awesome too.
Absolutely. Thank you very much, Heidi. Round of applause for all of our folks who introduced. There are more opportunities to engage and to talk in just a bit, but so that we can get down the road on some ideas, and then we'll come back for some group discussion just a bit. In the last session, or the opening session, I shared or reminded us that students come to college. They come to LBCC for ultimately getting jobs and careers, to make money and to be successful. I also shared during that time that we know a lot about success, that generally speaking, success doesn't look like this. One, because students don't live in boxes. But also, in my research with students, interviews, surveys, students have their own measures or metrics for success. You know, I met a student in Memphis at Union College, a first generation Latina, who was studying something like architecture, who said to me that success for her is not measured by what job she gets, by how much money she makes, nor is it measured by the position or the title that she'll have. Success for her was being able to finish college and then go back home and build for her mom the kitchen that her mom so rightfully deserved because she was an amazing cook. And for that student, that is a more personally grounded measure of success. I've met students at colleges all across the country who are studying business, who want to use these skills to maybe start their own small company, to go back home and work in a nonprofit, or even to start or support an existing grassroots organization. And they become really frustrated when they're in the classroom with faculty who teach them like the only way that you can be successful with a business degree is to go work on Wall Street or to have some corporate internship or to end up making six digits. So success is not always defined for our students the way that we would think about success. And if we're gonna connect with students of color, I think we have to be willing to open up to more culturally relevant, culturally appropriate measures of success. That for some students, the greatest measure of their success has nothing to do with them at all. It's the ability to use this wonderful resource called education to go back and lift other boats, to lift the lives and spirits of other people, to help their family members. You know, I've interviewed, sat down, and talked to students time and time again who've talked to faculty and staff who say things like, you have to integrate, become involved on campus, stop going home all the time. And I think that is another intellectual, cultural, maybe even psychological chasm. It is a way that it keeps us from engaging students of color effectively. Because we think of it as, yeah, just be here. Come to college more, come to campus more. That's great, you gotta be here. This is where I am, this is where learning happens. But for many students of color, not going home, not going back home, not calling back home, not keeping in touch with the people who represent home, for them would be like academic suicide. They can't be successful here without the support of home. And that they wouldn't be here if it hadn't been for home. And that home and campus, though we don't work hand in hand like we should, home and campus for them have to be connected. You know, what when we start to appreciate the ties and supports and communities that our students have to home, then I think it allows us to engage them more effectively. Without that kind of cultural frame of reference, we will continue to see low student of color rates where students of color tend to underperform. And I so greatly appreciate Mike's observation about African-American men, because we certainly know that Black men are underrepresented in higher education. So too are Latino men. Men of color generally are underrepresented in higher education and struggle, listen to this, struggle in higher education. They do not struggle with higher education. Struggle with, I think, is a deficit perspective. It's the idea that men of color can't make it in college. That's simply not true. There are lots of, you're looking at a man of color who made it in higher education, and you're in the room with other men of color who are making it in higher education. So men of color can succeed in higher education. The challenge is higher education struggles to really educate men of color. The system is not set up to support and educate most men of color. In fact, if you listen to the Chronicle of Higher Education and several news sources, you could probably start to realize that higher education, education generally, is marginalizing for most men. Why men in general are the numerical majority in higher education today. Most colleges are majority women. And then certainly men of color, really their achievement rates are consistently lower than their peers. And a lot of it has to do with how higher education is structured and delivered. If this were my class and I were the instructor, just sort of modeling teaching in higher education, I might do something like this. I might show you a film. And usually instructors do one of two things when they're showing a film. They go off to the side so they're not standing in the way of the film. They go disappear, go to the restroom, go to their office, whatever, make the students watch the film. They've already seen the film. They saw the film in order to pick the film for class. So they're not going to sit there and watch the film there. They go off and they do something else, or they start checking their email, doing something. I mean, most instructors on average, if this is not you, you are not the average, but most instructors, listen to this, disengage when they want students to engage. And that to me is problematic, because one of the things that we've learned from decades of research is that we as instructors have to model what we want our students to do. So if you look disinterested and then you're wondering why students look disinterested, there's a connection. So we show a film, but let's just say it's a model classroom, right? So we show a film and we sit right here on the front, and students don't watch us checking our email or our text. They watch us watching the film. And they're like, whoa, they're watching. Guess I should watch. And now they're watching the film. The moment the film is over, most instructors, well-trained, highly regarded, award-winning, smell great, look great, get into the front of the room, and what do they say? They say, all right, so let's talk about the film. How did it make you feel? And what we don't realize all the time is that is a question that most men cannot answer. And it's because we in this room and outside this room have built a society that socializes men to be disconnected from their feelings. To be emotional is to be non-masculine. That is not true, but that is the message of society. Real men are stoic. Real men are hard veneered. I don't even know what that means, just hard faced, I guess. Real men don't cry. But then we ask students to tell us how you feel. Some of us even take it to the next level. Hey, take out a sheet of paper. Or tonight for assignment, I want you to write how you feel. Oh my gosh. Most men cannot complete that assignment. And if they do complete that assignment, it is a serious learning curve for them. And it's not just trying to recall from the film, what did I remember? It's that there's another curriculum for them, another challenge. That is, how do I get in touch with these feelings that society and my mom, my dad, my stepdad, my grandfather, my great-grandfather, the media have taught me all my life to get away from? And this instructor tells me in a minute, get connected with. happens in school, it happens in higher education. And it causes some of the achievement problems with men and men of color. Men of color not only have to, you know, that added piece of how do I now, you know, reconstruct my whole conceptualization of masculinity? How do I redefine how I think about myself as a man in order for me to complete this task in this classroom or to complete this assignment, but also do it in a way that when I write it or when I speak it, for sometimes the first time ever in my life, I don't seem inarticulate. I won't be judged as dumb. I won't confirm someone's stereotype that I wasn't supposed to be here anyway. I won't be viewed as some dumb black jock. And that's how the stereotype and the beliefs are racialized for men of color that keep them trapped. Literally, I was in a classroom one time on a college campus watching students. I was doing a classroom observation, and I watched the prisons that some students live in. That which I just described, that's a psychological prison for some men of color who sit there fighting all, will they think I'm dumb? Will I say it the right way? Who's looking at me? Who's judging me? Do they think how do I feel? I don't know how I feel. What if I say it the wrong way? Before you know it, they've missed the opportunity to engage in the discussion. And most of us, woke faculty members, you know, conscious faculty members say things like, he just doesn't engage. He just doesn't seem excited enough. He's not putting forth the effort. When in fact, I would argue that if we could really detect the psychological energy that's expended, he sometimes is putting in more effort than the average student. You just don't see it. Because a lot of the effort is expended in the mind and in the body. The problem with this is all psychological research and experiments converge on this fact, and that is energy spent anywhere is at the expense of using it elsewhere. If I'm thinking about what you're going to think of what I say, if I'm thinking about how I'm going to be judged, if I'm thinking about how I feel, if I'm thinking about what I'm going to eat, if I'm thinking about if I'm going to have enough money to pay my bills, all this is going on in the classroom. That means that what psychologists call working memory, or some people call bandwidth, that concept of bandwidth, it's shrinking for that learner. Some of it goes towards these racial stereotypes. Some of them go towards gender stereotypes. Some of them go towards racism. Some of them go towards, I'm hungry, I got bills to pay. What about my kids I dropped off? How are they doing? And now some students have this much bandwidth to devote to your class, and some students are on a little thread. And it shows up in ways that we as instructors either reward some students with good grades because they have enough bandwidth to look like they're engaged and to pay attention and to nod and to laugh at our jokes even when they're dry. And some students are holding on with a little bit of bandwidth in ways that we would typically describe as disengaged, not interested, not college material, not cut out for the class, not paying attention. So I think if we want to engage students, we have to, one, do a couple of things. Let me just actually do this so that I can get these on the screen, and then I can move through them. All right, so I'm just gonna offer these. Whoops, sorry. What's showing up? Here we go. I'm just gonna offer these, and I can come back through them. So there are things that we can do that can really help us connect with men of color. Now, so I'm a man of color. I'm still a man of color. I was a student of color because I believe in lifelong learning. I believe I'm still a student of color. I remember being in grad school learning about men of color and hearing men of color, you know, don't seek help and men of color aren't engaged and all this stuff. And I wrote really copious notes about myself as if I'm not myself, and then regurgitated it on tests and said, yeah, men of color don't seek help and they're not engaged. And then one day I hit the 3-0 mark. That's all I'm gonna tell you folks. I'm 30 years or older, okay? So I hit the 3-0. When I hit 3-0, all my friends were going to the gym. And I was like, oh my gosh, I need a gym membership. Now, I don't know why I need a gym membership. I've been this size since like kindergarten. It is unlikely that I'm gonna get any bigger or any smaller or taller or anything. But my friends were all at the gym, so I remember thinking, I need a gym membership. And I went to the gym membership. Now remember, I've been socialized, that is taught, trained, tested, to believe that men of color don't seek help and they're never engaged, really. And I go to the gym. Now, I'm a newcomer to the gym. This is my first time. I hadn't been to the gym since like high school. And I didn't like the gym in high school because it was like the site of my oppression. One, I have no hair on my legs. I know that's TMI, but it is a true statement. And when you are an adolescent boy growing up in public school and you had the courage to go into the gymnasium and you have no hair on your legs, oh my gosh, you are teased and you are beaten and you're abused. And I mean, this is well before bullying had a name. And then the second reason why I never really liked going into the gym was because I'm no good at anything that happens in the gym. I'm not good at basketball, I'm not good at football, I don't even like football. I mean, I like football players as people, but most football players would like knock my teeth out because my teeth are about where their shoulders are, right? Because of my height problem. And so before you know it, I picked up this implicit, that is, it was not obvious to me, but this implicit belief about the misalignment between my body and the gym. So much so that I stayed away from it all my life. And when I went back as an adult who paid for a membership to go to this gym, all of those feelings resurfaced. I got into a Gold's Gym. And I walk in, before you know it, I'm concerned about my hairless legs. I go out with my gloves and my gear that I got from Dick's Sporting Goods, and I'm worried, who's judging me? Who's looking at me? Why is my body not as big as their body? How long will it take? I don't even want my body to be as big as their body. But before you know it, they become my comparison. The reason why this is really powerful is most of my work, most of my life, is connected to my work. It's not that I'm a workaholic. I'm happy to be a workaholic. But sometimes when I'm having these very ordinary personal experiences, the professor in me wakes up and says, you know this relates to your research, right? And so I'm sitting here in the gym and I'm like, wow, for some students, they step into the classroom and it activates all those fears and worries and anxieties that they had when they were in grade school. Because the classroom, for some students, was the site of oppression.
And by the time they get to us, it's the way they got to us is by laying low. The way they got to us is by flying under the radar. And they might not actively participate or be engaged, quote unquote, as much as we might think they are. But I think just given the statistics, right? I mean, if we look at the overrepresentation of us in prison, in the prison industrial complex, like just to get to where we're at, especially, we teach in communities here that are, very much, struggling. And so just to get to us, you had to not be the troublemaker. You had to kind of be quiet. And sometimes I see that in the classroom, like they won't engage, but it's a matter of just laying low and kind of getting by. And I think that's also something we need to be cognizant of instead of like sort of railing against why they don't participate, that's, at least that's been my experience as far as the way I've seen it in my class.
Yes, what I hear you also affirming is the idea that engagement looks different for some people. Some people, let me tell you, I was giving a talk in, where am I right now? California, okay. So I was giving a talk in Missouri, East St. Missouri, no, East St. Louis, which is next to Missouri. And I was their commencement speaker, graduation speaker. And I've given graduation and commencement talks before, and they always are fun to give because everybody's excited on graduation day, and everybody's like so happy for their learner, their student. So I'm sitting here, I'm giving this talk on this graduation day or this commencement day, and at some point in my talk, there's all this murmuring. It's like everyone was listening. I knew I had everyone's attention. And then I hear this murmur, it's like undercurrent. And it's throwing me off because it's starting to get so loud that I'm like, are people booing? What is going on? I've never been booed before. And as I, so I'm starting to like lower my voice just so I can hear what's happening. It wasn't a boo, but it was a murmur. And at the end of it, I mean, it was just so frustrating. And then it went away. And then I finished my talk. At the end of my talk, adults came up to me and said things like, oh, I really enjoyed your keynote. Oh, you were dynamic. Oh, you were great. And one woman came up, she said, I really liked your talk, some of it, not all of it. I said, not all. She said, you didn't hear me over there saying, that ain't right. And she was like, you know, I said, what? Yeah, I did hear that. It was really loud, actually. I said, what part did you disagree with? She said, that whole part about going to college. Because Stephanie is not going to college. I said, who's Stephanie? She points to Stephanie, who's in her graduation cap and gown. She said, Stephanie's not going to college. She's not going to waste my time and my money going to college. She's going to just get a job and work, just like I had to work. I see some people nodding. I see some people like they just saw a ghost. This is good because it was the first time. I mean, I've heard about it and I've probably even written about it, but it was the first time I stood in the face of a mom who would not support her daughter's college aspirations. A few weeks ago, I was at a school, at a community college in Michigan. During the Q&A, a student raised their hand and said, Dr. Strayhorn, you keep talking about support, you keep talking about belonging, you keep talking about whatever. What advice do you have for us if you can't find that support? And the one place you surely can't find it is at home. These are the questions that are on the minds of some of our students. So this idea that mom, dad, auntie, uncle, home, you know, partner, whoever is like, yes, go get that degree. You keep going. The sky's the limit is not true. And the same is true for a lot of men of color who have been socialized, programmed, trained to just lay low. Then they come to campus and now all of a sudden we want people to be engaged. We want them to pay attention. We want them to be empathetic. We want them to be excited. And I think it's not unrealistic, but I do think that it is the space from where they are to where we want them to be is so large. That gap is so big that they can't get there without our support. It's gonna take faculty who are aware of these realities, who say things like, you know, for instance, let me check my own. Why does engagement always have to look like excitement? You know what? As a person, I am an introvert. Most people do not know this. They think I'm an extrovert. I'm an introvert. What I'm doing right now is expending a lot of energy. You can't tell. You're not supposed to be able to tell. In fact, if you could tell, then I failed at my job, right? But if I'll expend it all, and then I will disappear from this campus, and I will go right to that hotel, and I will crash. I will get on a plane. I will not crash, like, physically, but I mean just, like, fall down, okay? So get on a plane to fly back home, and I tweet about this all the time. And the person, I feel so sorry for the person who sits beside me on the plane today because I'm not speaking. I'm not. I've been speaking all day long by the time I've seen them. I need to recharge. I've exhausted a lot of energy. And what I used to do before I started paying attention to the things we talked about, I would go into the classroom and I would reward, praise, celebrate, appreciate students who were hyper like me. But you don't have to be hyper to be a good student. There are some students who are engaged and their engagement looks like this. There's some students who are listening to you and they're not going to nod. They're not nodders. But they're listening and they're taking notes. So faculty have an enormous responsibility if we really want to engage today's diverse learner to first start with ourselves. What am I assuming engagement looks like? What am I assuming readiness looks like? What does a smart student look like? And to check all of those biases at the door. The good thing about bias is this. When you come in thinking that all smart students sit at the front, it's not true. Some people couldn't possibly, socially, they cannot stand the physical, they are wired such that being in the front is to be on display. And they were socialized, born, and raised with the spirit of humility. Where the best place for them to be in the classroom is toward the back or the middle. It's not because they don't like you. It's not because they're disengaged. It's because before you ever taught them, grandma taught them and grandpa taught them. Don't you be getting in there running in front of the class like you all hot and bothered and so fancy pants. You sit in the back and just take good notes. You're lucky to be at that college. That's their reality. But then they come in the classroom, we say things like, well, smart people sit at the front. You know, students who are serious about their learning sit at the front. It's not true. So if we can appreciate these differences, it allows us to be, I think, a far more effective instructor and to realize that actually what might look like disengagement may very well be engagement. And contrary to popular belief, students of color and, dare I say, men of color can engage and seek help. So I'm in the gym and I realize, oh my gosh, I'm experiencing all these moments. Well, finally, I decide I'm gonna lift some weights. I don't know why, but I decided I was gonna lift some weights. So I went to go lift some weights and I realized when I sat down to lift weights, I know nothing about lifting weights. I don't even know how to get started. So I watched another guy lift weights. By the way, watching this other guy reminds me of something. I'll come back to this slide. It's probably on this next one. That one, right here. That one way that we can engage students and students can be successful is if we can raise their confidence. I think it would be really cool is if when on the first day of class, as students are coming into the class, if we could give them a little quick survey to measure their confidence. You would learn that not only are our students different on day one when they come into your class in terms of their race, their gender, their academic ability, their test score, their placement score, they are also different in their level of confidence in their ability to succeed in your class. And the reason why that's important to know is that we know that part of success is dependent upon confidence. You can have all the resources in the world, all the training in the world, but if you're not confident in your ability to do something, you're not even gonna try to do it. Because most people are failure averse. We try our best to not fail. Most parents live their lives trying to keep their kids from failing. So we are a society that does not like failure. But learning actually requires, if nothing else, failure. You learn from failure. In fact, failure is often heralded as the best teacher, right? So a willingness to fail is necessary sometimes for students to succeed. Well, in order for you to succeed, you gotta have confidence. And we know something about confidence. There are three levers for raising confidence. One of them I illustrated or followed in the gym is called vicarious experiences. Simply watching somebody do something teaches me some of the parts of what to do. Before you know it, it increases my confidence in my own ability to do it. That's why if you're an instructor who teaches and you use demonstrations or you say things like, I'm gonna show you first and then I want you to do it, or watch the video and then you're gonna try it at your seats, or here are the steps, I'm gonna 1, 2, 3, here's how to analyze the data or how to execute this or complete this task, and then you offer students a chance to do it on their own, that is good teaching because it offers the student an opportunity to watch someone do it, which increases their confidence regardless of where they start, and now they all should be increased in confidence, maybe not at the same point, but increasing their confidence to do it, and now they're willing to try it. The second way to increase confidence is verbal persuasion, simply telling students you can do it. Nike figured this out years ago, just do it. Just tell people they can do it and people start trying stuff. If you're an instructor who has not told your students this semester that they can do it, when you see them again, tell them. You can do this. I don't know if I've told you this semester, but regardless of what your grade is right now in this class, you can be successful here. Now, some of you may have to study more than others. Some of you may have to come see me during my office hours or before class or after class. But the one thing I absolutely know is that you can be successful here. And I'm not even gonna ask you, what was your last grade in math or what did you do last year? I don't care about all that. All I care about is what's gonna happen in this classroom right now. And what you will do if I teach stats. And when I teach stats, I tell people this exact thing. You will be successful with stats. I don't care if you don't like math. I don't even care if you don't like numbers. You're gonna be successful with stats. And you're gonna say, well, I failed stats last year. And that's because you didn't have me as your instructor. But this semester, you and I working together as a team, everybody in here is gonna succeed. Part of what I'm doing is raising confidence. And yes, students feel good. And yeah, they say, oh my gosh, he's so nice. But ultimately what they don't know is I'm also plugging into their wires, their intellect, and increasing confidence because they are significantly more likely to try my assignment when I do that than if I don't do it. Confidence is really important. And then the third and final is mastery experiences. You can talk to them all day. You can let them watch people all day, but ultimately they have to roll up their sleeve and start trying it themselves. And that mastery experiences is a process. It's not an experience. Mastery comes quite often through experimentation and failure. And most people who have succeeded only got there by moving through the hallway of failure. Multiple attempts at that. So as instructors, I think we should also build scaffold learning so that students can try, experiment,
fail, miss, get feedback. Because all of that is part of the process of eventual success. Well, I'm in the gym and I'm watching this guy lift weights and I'm like, okay. Then I start lifting weights and it's not like that. I start way slower than that. But interestingly enough, as he's putting more weights on his bar, I start putting more weights on my bar. Now, someone should have told me that there is a limit to exactly how much I can emulate him. Now, I mean, we're almost twins. He's like 6'1", he's about 240 pounds. I'm this. And I'm sitting here, he puts a weight on, I put a weight on. We start lifting, I'm looking, I'm like, okay, he puts a weight on, but I put a weight on. And at some point, I lift the weight, and, well, actually, I try to lift the weight, and the weight won't move. Now, after I kick and struggle and pray and ask my grandma's spirit to help me, I finally get this weight up. But it is extremely heavy. I'm pretty sure I'm not supposed to be lifting this weight. I can get the weight down, but I cannot get it back up. And as I'm sitting here, and I honestly thought, there are two times in my life where I thought for more than maybe 2 seconds, I'm talking like a 15-minute brain thought about dying. You know, one time I was in an elevator, and have you ever pressed I pressed the elevator button, and the door wouldn't open, and it wasn't moving. I was like, oh my gosh, I'm trapped. And within 2 seconds, I started feeling like I was trapped, and I was hyperventilating, and I was like, oh my gosh, I'm gonna pass out. And I'd only been in there like for 15 seconds, but I went from 0 to 1,000 really, really fast. And I thought, oh my gosh, I'm gonna die in this elevator. I can see the headlines tomorrow, professor dies in elevator, you know? And then the elevator doors open. I'm like, gosh, I gotta calm down, you know? Then I'm in the gym this day, and this bar is on my chest. I'm like, in my head, I can't get this up. There, Long Beach, I'm serious. Like, even when I try to move my arm, it's like I don't even have enough strength in my arm to make the bar move. In fact, I can start to feel the bar across my chest. It hurts. I'm pretty sure it's squashing my heart. That's not good, because if it squashes my heart so much, I won't be able to breathe. Do you realize that this is going on for probably 2.5 minutes? I have not hollered out for help. I've not motioned for help. You know what? In fact, I'm trying to keep it a secret. And just when I was about to just say, okay, Grandma, I'm coming to meet you, I saw a hand reach over the bar. I thought it was Jesus. I really did. I saw a hand reach over the bar and grab the bar and lift it off of me. When I looked up, it was the guy who I was watching lift weights who came over. He said, what in the world are you doing? I said, what are you doing? I was lifting weights. He said, you were not. You were about to die. You were just laying there with this bar. Why didn't you scream out for help? This is crazy. He said, you know what? You got to get all these weights off. You have too many weights. You can't lift all that. I said, you lift. He said, I'm a bodybuilder. What are you? I said, I'm a professor. Why would the professor be trying to do what the bodybuilder's doing? They need two separate amounts of weight. After we sit there and have this conversation, he said, now, if you want to lift weights, I will help you. I will spot you. I said, spot me? What does that mean? He said, spot you. I'll make sure that your weights are balanced, and then I'll put your weights, you'll lift the weights, and as long as you're doing well, my job as the spotter is to cheer you on. Just say, keep going, man, and to keep count. 1 rep, 2 rep, 3 rep, 4 rep. Just keep encouraging you. But the moment it looks like you're having, like you were a few minutes ago, where your arms are too weak or you can't manage to get the weight off of you, my job is to rescue you, to help you get it back to the bar. I sat up, I ran to the front desk, I grabbed a sheet of paper and a pen, I wrote down academic spotting. Because it was in the gym that I realized that men of color actually do engage and actually do not only seek help, they offer help. Now, they don't do it in classrooms because classrooms aren't as cool as gyms, I don't think. I think there are ways in which we can convert our classroom environment so that they are more interactive where, but listen to this, I was about to die for 2.5 minutes and never even hollered out for help. In fact, I was literally trying to keep my struggle internal. It's just like students who sit in our class struggling. They don't understand the lecture. The equations don't make sense. what you're talking about doesn't even make sense. I don't remember any of the reading because I didn't do it. Or if I did do it, it made no sense to me then. It makes no sense to me now. And we don't raise our hand and say, I'm sorry, I'm lost. Could you start from page one and just like walk me through? I'm talking about the language, the none of this is making sense. Nobody does it. They don't do it in classrooms. They don't even do it in gyms when they have 200 pounds of weight on their chest. We are conditioned, programmed, wired to start dealing with that struggle internally, which is why I think instructors have to be all the time present, paying attention to ask pulse checks, asking things making sense, any questions. Stop me at any time. It is okay to stop me. I'm here to help. If it makes no sense for me to go on if you don't get it here. And to scan the audience to make sure that we are able to provide the support the students need, to normalize the idea that everybody needs help. Everybody has questions. What we know from psychological research is that most students don't believe that. They think that, I'm just gonna say it the way that students talk about it in research. They think that dumb people ask questions. They think that people who are behind ask questions. They think that people who are stupid ask questions. Only smart people don't ask questions. And what we need to do as instructors is change that whole narrative. One way you can do it is simply saying it. Two thing is who's got questions? What I like to do in my own teaching is I like to celebrate questions. All right, I'm so excited. Who's got questions? All right, who's got questions for me? Sounds exciting, like questions are a good thing. He looks forward to questions. And when people have, oh, good, you have a question. Oh, this is great. Yes, a question.
I like that.
You know, so by doing it, we normalize this idea that in this space, In the process of learning, we ask questions. And then ultimately, we realize that, you know, what I love to do is when I get a sense for my class. What's your name? Say it again.
Marie.
Laura. Marie. If I know that Marie's doing, I know, you don't know, but I know from my interactions with her during my office hours and my feedback on her assignments, she's doing really great. And I happen to know that Brad is doing great, but his greatness looks different. Then rather than say, Brad, you know, why don't you just write down all your questions and I'll address them in class. I'll say something like, do you have a question? Or who has a question? Brad might have a question. And I'll say something like, all right, for a few moments, I want you to pair up. Marie, would you go talk with Brad? I'll connect them. And the class won't know why I'm doing it. But what I'm actually doing is taking a student who can also act as a TA for me, and I know that she's going to be able to answer a lot of Brad's questions, not all of them, but a lot of them, and I start pairing students up across these performance areas, these performance gaps, so that students are actually learning from peers, which is really important to build peer connections and peer relationships, but also to get help right there in the moment. Before you know it, these two start talking to each other, they start developing a relationship, they might even exchange numbers, I'm not sure. And now, even when I'm not around, other people can help Brad or students like Terrell get the support they need. I'm gonna stop for a second. Questions, reactions, thoughts? Yes.
Hi.
Hi.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's really great for students. You know, so much of this, those kinds of tools, so I recommend it as well, help us develop our practice of teaching. We are teachers. It's an identity. for us. But many people come to the identity without formal training in the practice of it. We adopt the identity. I am professor, I am instructor, I am teacher, but haven't gone through a formal training, yes, in the subject matter. Yes, we've had professional work experience that affirms our professional identity, the sense that, yeah, I feel like I'm an instructor and I ought to be able to teach this. But the mechanics of teaching, how do you make the complex simple? How do you take something that is written and make it graphic? It takes tools for us to make that transition or that transformation. And I think those kinds of tools really matter. Most teachers teach like they were taught. And I think the problem with that is, generally speaking, most reports over the decades have suggested that we weren't taught well. So we're doing the very best with what we've got. We have all these tools and equipments that usually only confuse us unless we are trained to use them effectively in our instruction. And the student then becomes the recipient of that confusion. And that then creates more factors that influence the odds for their success, or reduce, really, the odds for their success. Yes, a hand in the back. Yep. So three strategies. That's what we were here for, right? More strategies. So In-N-Out Burger, I've only been to once. But I've lived in places where there aren't In-N-Out Burgers. But I do know this. I live now in Nashville, Tennessee, and I just moved there a couple months ago, and they have an In-N-Out Burger. Haven't gone to it yet. But from my understanding of how these things, you know, I said in the opening session, we now live in a day and age where the largest hotel is Airbnb and the largest taxi service is Uber and Lyft. We are pretty soon going to be living in a day and age where the best takeout is not anything, it's Uber Eats, right? So you can order up food and the driver will deliver the food to your house. I think there's wisdom there for us in education. And that is, if we don't want the long In-N-Out Burger line at the end of class, well, there are a couple things we could do. One, we can offer students have it. I've talked to thousands, tens of thousands of students in the course of my career. I've never met a single, well, that's not true. All but one student has ever told me they don't have a smart device, a phone, an iPad, or something. And the one student who told me that they didn't have a smart device said, I don't have a smart device, all I have is an iPad. And an iPad is actually a smart device, so they don't even count. Every student has access to something somewhere, and this is interesting, but we do live in a society where it's ubiquitous, it's all over the place. What if you, so in my classrooms, I say things like, instead of forming a line, look, here's my Twitter account. If you have a question and you're comfortable with it, tweet it. If you're not comfortable with it being on social media, DM me. Just put it in my direct message. And during class, when I put them on break, I check Twitter. And the questions that are like one-to-one, I don't discuss those. I write that person back. But if there's a good question I think the group would benefit from, I study it during break. When we come back from break, I'm like, oh my gosh, we got a good question in the room. And here's the question, I ask it. And what I've learned is I can reduce the line before class and after class, because what students really want is they just want their question answered. However we can get it answered. And engaging social media, Twitter's just one example. There are free, you know, everyone in this room would be eligible for an education account at polleverywhere.com. You are an instructor at an accredited institution. You can get a free education account at polleverywhere.com, and what it allows you to do is to, on the screen, tell your students, if you have a question, text this number, and they text the number, I have a question, and if, as long as you have your projector set up, as the questions come in, they'll pop up on the screen. Does not tell you who it is, but it simply is a question. And if you don't need to know who it is, it's a great way to get comments on the screen. And you're teaching and you're doing all this, but every now and again you look back and you're like, oh, there's a question, there's a question. And it's a way for students to, it cuts down the line, but also the thing it gives students is I can ask the question and nobody knows. Which for some reason students, I think until we can really normalize the fact that everybody has questions, and really, really smart people, including instructors, have questions, students would prefer for that to be anonymous. And what'd you say? You see? Yeah. And then the third and final one is, I don't know how you use your office hours, but sometimes students hang out after, at least in my experience, because they don't know when they can connect with us. And so being very clear with students about our office hours and when we're available and so forth, and holding those times, I think is another way to cut down that line. All right, so because we're out of time and I wanna make sure you get your break so you can go to your next thing, I'm gonna stop here. But if you have other questions, you know my email address and I'm happy to entertain any as we're heading back out. But give yourselves a round of applause and enjoy your very next session.